So I am the director of the Keck Institute for Space Studies, but did you catch it? Michelle is the managing director of the Keck Institute for Space Studies. So she is the person that really makes everything that we do at the Institute really work and succeed. Very briefly, for those of you who don't know about the Keck Institute for Space Studies, you can think of us as a think tank for space science and space engineering. We initiate about roughly a half dozen programs on various topics each year. They cover the gamut from planetary science to solar system science to Earth science to astrophysics to space engineering. Just to give you an example, perhaps our best known program, some of you will probably have heard of it, was that we had a program in 2012 where we decided to explore the audacious idea of capturing an asteroid and bringing it back to lunar orbit for astronauts to visit. That was kind of, we even thought it was a crazy idea, but we went after it. And that has led indeed to the NASA ARM asteroid redirector rendezvous mission, which is going to be a $1 billion mission, which is currently under development at NASA. But we do a wide range of programs. I'll just give you a few examples. We are funding the instrumentation of the LA Basin for greenhouse gases as part of the Megacities Project. We are funding the development of autonomous underwater vehicles as platforms for developing risk-tolerant software. We're also funding instrumentation on towers and various ecosystems in order to give ground truth for global photosynthesis measurements. So those are just a few examples. We do a very wide range of programs and studies. Today, you're going to see a different type of program that we sponsor, and that is we are very interested in the future generation of space explorers. And so because of that, we specifically support here at Caltech programs that are initiated by students, proposed by students, led by students, and implemented by students. And so that's one of the programs. That's today's program. This particular program has been developed by the Student Social Activism Speaker Series. They select the speakers. They take care of the arrangements. And then we actually support them in bringing the speakers here to Caltech. So I am not here to introduce the speaker, but I am here to introduce Nate Thomas. Nate Thomas is a student here at Caltech. He's on the executive committee of the Social Activism Speaker Series. And Nate is working to get his PhDs in material science, researching nanostructures for selective absorption of solar thermal energy. And so he'll introduce our today's speaker. So Nate.
Thank you for the introduction. Briefly, I would also like to thank the Keck Institute for Space Studies for their partnership and in their support in putting this event together. I would also like to thank Tony Leonard, our current faculty advisor, and George Hillou, our previous advisor, in helping in their guidance for organizing this talk. Quickly, I'd also like to encourage any of the students in the audience that might be interested in bringing engaging speakers to campus to possibly join SAS. And visit one of our executive committee meetings. Any of you that would be interested, please feel free to talk to me after the lecture. It is my great pleasure to introduce our speaker, Dr. Scott Pace. Dr. Pace is the director of the Space Policy Institute and professor of the practice of the international affairs at George Washington University's Elliott School of International Affairs. He's also a member of the faculty of the Trachtenberg School of Public Policy and Public Administration. His research interests include civil, commercial, national security, space policy, and management and technical innovation. Dr. Pace received a Bachelor of Science degree in physics right down the road at Harvey Mudd. Master's degrees, that's plural, in aeronautics and astronautics and technology and policy from MIT, and a doctorate in policy analysis from Rand Graduate School in 1989. He has served in the White House Office of Science, Technology, Policy for the RAND Corporation Science and Technology Institute and the Office of Deputy Secretary of the Department of Commerce, among many other places. More recently, he has served as a member of the U.S. delegation to the UN Committee on the Peaceful Uses
of outer space in 2009 and from 2011 to 2012. So we are very excited to hear what he has prepared for us today on the implications of U.S. space policy choices. So please help me in welcoming Dr. Scott Pace.
And of course, space is nothing except a debugging operation, eternal debugging operation. Okay, thank you. It's quite an honor to be here. I used to come to Caltech on Saturdays, with a bunch of other high school students, and take math and physics classes and so forth. It was one of the social activism, I think, things back in the 70s. My first job out of high school was at JPL in the summer of 1976 when Viking landed on Mars. And, you know, there was champagne all over the lab, and every bucket, every wastebasket seemed to have a champagne bottle in it. And I said, this is great. I'm working here every summer. This is great. I worked as a technician at JPL during the summers while I was going to that small college down the river at Harvey Mudd. If it helps anybody here, my roommate did go to Caltech in surface science, so there is still that connection. But as you heard from, you know, the introduction, I started off in physics. Low-temperature physics, in fact. One of the projects I worked on was the infrared astronomy satellite a long time ago. But then I fell through engineering, so I wound up working at Rockwell Shuttle Orbiter Division in the early 80s when we were building shuttles, and of course now they're in museums. I also wound up then going to the RAND Corporation, as I realized that a lot of the issues that I cared a lot about were not in space, were not driven really by technical issues, and even not so much by financial issues as they were really by policy choices. And why do we make these decisions? Who makes them? How are they made? Why are they made? What determines one road or another that you might go on? Because plainly, it wasn't derivable from F equals MA. There was other things that were plainly going on. And so in the course of trying to understand that, from physics through engineering and then into public policy, of course, my colleagues thought I was, you know, descending into management. There was no hope. But I found it to be actually a very interesting and worthwhile process because what you learn in the space policy business about is how much your life involves translating between different communities, not just between different technical communities, but legal communities, procurement, political, international. We all speak some variation of English from time to time, but it means something completely, completely different. Also, as you heard a bit from the introduction, I've been in industry, I've been in think tanks, I've been in government, both as a civil servant and a political appointee. And each one of these environments, while it might look the same on the surface, you know, we wear ties, a lot of us, I'm from Washington, sorry, I wear a tie. We work on computers, we go to meetings and so forth, it looks the same on the surface. But the social DNA underneath all that and the motivations and incentives that organizations have are very, very different. And so trying to understand those variations and differences in the course of choosing what do we do in space is what I want to talk about. So starting off with, Roger Larnius is a friend of mine. He's at the National Air and Space Museum. Sketches out some very basic reasons about why do we people do this. And these are sort of the canonical five that he came up with. And I find this useful just as a framing exercise. I mean, first of all, there's this stuff about, you know, human destiny, survival of the species, the particularly American image of going out on the frontier. There are geopolitical and national pride and prestige reasons. This is certainly is what it's driven space business for a long time. Certainly the Apollo race to the moon, the Apollo Soyuz mission to symbolize detente in the 70s, the decision to build the space station as part of an anti-Soviet coalition and bringing in the emerging programs in Europe and Japan. The decision by the Clinton administration to bring the Russians into the space station as part of symbolizing what would a post-Soviet program and space program look like and post-Soviet relationship look like. We're seeing some of the consequences of that today. National security and military applications. Certainly we would not have the arms control agreements we do have without the reconnaissance satellites. And of course the threat that was created by ICBMs and the dual use technology of rocket propulsion. Economic competition and satellite applications. really, given the cost of sending things to space, it's not surprising that the things that make money in space are things that don't weigh anything, photons going up and down carrying information. Maybe space tourism will occur where the payload pays to go, but for now, the things that make money in space tend to be information. And if you look at where the new applications are coming from today, right, today is largely extensions of information technology, and I can talk a little bit more about that later. And then finally, scientific discovery and understanding, really, which is what JPL and Caltech specialize in, is expanding the frontiers of human knowledge. So these are sort of whole ranges of reasons why one might engage in spaceflight. I would argue that today, while there are deep, deep difficulties and challenges in each area of spaceflight, it's really human spaceflight that is in the most precarious position. And I'll talk about that in a moment. If you think about the different sectors of space policy, you can think of them as really there's three areas that kind of break down into subsets. National security, which covers both military and intelligence. Those two cultures are very different. So when we want to talk about military and intelligence functions, we'll say national security. If we actually mean military or we actually mean intelligence functions, we'll say that separately. Commercial, things like satellite communications. Civil, scientific research, as well as public service functions, you know, like weather forecasts. And you can put these things along a spectrum by whether they're driven by markets or driven by governments. Now, some things, like satellite communications, really a satellite is competing not with other satellites, it's competing with ground-based alternatives. I mean, why have a satellite if maybe I could do a fiber optic cable? Well, in some cases, it's because the receiver is moving and the fiber optic cable can't keep up, so a mobile satellite might make sense. But the market for satellite communications, private capital, private markets, private investment, that's pretty much driven. There are government regulations and things that shape it, but the fundamental forces behind it are one of commercial economics. At the far end, if you think about things like space-based weapons, you really don't want them in the hands of the private sector. You know, there's not a space version of letters of mark and reprisal or anything like that. You want them under the control of governments. And then there's things that in the middle that are kind of a mixture. So if you think about the GPS system, it would not exist without the needs of the Air Force putting that up there. But if you look at what's happened on the ground, all the ground applications predominantly have been driven by commercial forces. Yes, there's military receivers. Yes, there's certain categories of aviation receivers. But things like survey and precision, construction, mining operations, so forth, all of that initiative and innovation has been happening by commercial force at the lower level. But those commercial forces would not exist without the government investment in those satellites. Similarly, early investment in remote sensing done for satellite reconnaissance purposes has evolved over time to where now people can put small sensors for the Earth, you know, on small satellites. So things like Planet Labs or Skybox and some of these other companies that are looking at feeding data into the large data aggregators like a Google. That's being driven now by much more commercial forces that are not space per se, they're really information data driven. But again, they would not exist without that prior investments. Now GPS, as I mentioned, is one of my favorites and one I actually spend a lot of time on because it's at this intersection of dual use technology. I mean, created for military purposes, but has found, you know, tons and tons of other civil and commercial and, of course, scientific purposes. And this is just a small sampling of these things. Now, part of the ubiquity of these applications comes from the fact that fundamentally GPS is really very simple. It's essentially its precision time. You know, it's a bunch of clocks up in space, you know, hi, I'm satellite number 12, beep, the time is. And from that very, very simple but profound piece of information, what time is it? You get enough of these things together, you get a position, you know, solve four equations and four unknowns and get the three-dimensional position. And you look at these things as they vary over time, you get a velocity, add it together with a map, you got a navigation system. And so anytime you want to know where and when I am, any application you can think of that requires that information, you're going to find GPS buried in there some way, which is sort of why it's called a global utility, because although it doesn't come out of a wall socket, it's something that's very, very broadly pervasive. Of course, a little bit dated chart. I'd like to get more of an update before this gets completely gone, but In the science community, space science community, this is probably no news to anybody in this audience, but oftentimes I have to sort of, remind audiences when we talk about space science, there's, again, multiple parts to it. There's folks looking at the Earth itself, people looking at the sun, people looking at the planets, people looking at the universe as a whole. So within the NASA science community, within the Science Mission Directorate, you have these different sub-empires, if you will, that go on, and they try not to jostle each other too much, but of course occasionally they do. The standard thing from a budgetary standpoint is you try to solve your problem within your project. If you have to go outside your project, you get more and more attention, and of course if you break out of your theme line entirely, like James Webb did, then you're going to get, pretty much agency-wide, if not national-level attention. So there's a series of escalating compartments that you go through, depending on your resources. But again, the purpose of showing this diagram is to say, really, the broad diversity that goes on in the science community, each of them with their own cultures, each with their own priorities. I was giving a talk to the National Research Council recently, the Space Studies Board, and of course they were gearing up, for the Earth Science Decadal. The decadal surveys are very, very popular, looked at very much by the political and budgetary process, not simply because people think the ideas are profound and interesting, but because the political process likes it when a community goes out and self-organizes. Okay, if you're a member of Congress or the staff, you're really, with one or two exceptions, not really in a position to go judge the scientific merit. You don't know. Why could you tell this university versus another? So you really like it when the community itself fights it out among themselves and comes up with priorities. Now, in some themes, such as astrophysics, it's a fairly well-defined, relatively speaking, fairly known community, and therefore coming up with sets of priorities within that community has been a routine one. In much more heterogeneous science communities like earth science, a lot harder. Getting water, ice, air people all to agree on relative priorities. I mean, that's really, really hard. So it's, again, no surprise that there's been less experience in fewer cycles, on the earth science side than there has been with the astrophysics side. But again, the reason that these are done is not to engage merely in academic exercises. It's in order for the political process to be able to say, these people made these judgments, now it's up to me to figure out how much to fund them. It's often a surprise to people, again, not maybe to this audience, but to tell them that NASA doesn't have science priorities. Science priorities come from the community, or at least they should for the most part. And what happens then is the science community sets those priorities and they say, now here's the bill, and of course there's never enough money to do all of them. But if you have the stack, you say, okay, I'm going to fund this one, this one, this one, I'm out of money. Okay, but at least you funded the top priorities. And so NASA, as a representative of the taxpayer, is responsible for saying, I need to fund these top priorities as much as I can and manage them as efficiently as I can. It is not NASA's job to determine what is science. That's the science community to do. If the science community doesn't do that job, somebody else will do it for them, I guarantee you. Okay, so while decadal surveys are not the answer to all problems, there is actually a nice symbiotic relationship between the community self-organization and then what the political process needs. You will note there is no such thing as a human spaceflight decadal. Okay, one, because exploration per se is not science. You can do science in the course of it, but it itself is not purely a scientific activity. It's done for all kinds of other reasons, recall the first chart, and therefore the decision process as to what to engage in and why is much more complicated than here. So while the science community is challenged by, there's never enough money, there's never enough time, the pipeline is getting thin, people are worried about, where the next coverage is going to come from, those are fundamentally programmatic concerns. Those are not existential concerns, like, are we even going to have an astrophysics program? We will have one. It may not be one somebody likes, but we are going to have an astrophysics program. The question is at what size and scope and all the rest of that. In the case of human spaceflight, the question is much more open, because people have had a more difficult time of saying, well, why are we doing that? So in an attempt to define why are we doing this, if you go back to NASA and you look at documentation, you start with the Organic Act, 1958, July 58, originally creating the NASA. And then there's subsequent modifications. There's an Authorization Act in 2010. There may or may not be another Authorization Act coming up soon. And then annual appropriations are made to fund whatever has been authorized. When people talk about space policy, they often think of things like these national space policy documents that has a White House logo on them and is put out. And there is a national space policy. You can go Google it up and produce the one from, you know, 2010 and read it. Similarly, there's a national space transportation policy in November 2013. These represent sort of high-level statements of kind of intents and desires and feelings, if you will, about space policy at the highest levels. This has gotten all the different parts of government, you know, having an input. And then these things are translated by agencies into more specific documents. In the case of NASA, there's the annual budget request that it negotiates with OMB. NASA then produces a strategic plan. And you can go down to finer and finer granularity with these things. There are outside documents. On the left, the National Academy of Science report. Those are the decadal studies that I mentioned. These are sort of exogenous inputs that come in. And there are things like the Augustine Commission. Various national commissions are set up every once in a while to look at some major issue, usually human spaceflight, people having questions about it. There was an earlier Augustine Commission in 1990 when the Hubble Space Telescope went up and found that it was somewhat myopic. And that was, you know, had made editorial cartoons around the country. And there was, again, our, you know, rubbing of hands and wondering what should we do. And so there's first and second Augustines. If you want to look for those reports. So, exogenous inputs, some ad hoc, some more organized, existing legislation modified by the Congress, policy documents that then sort of flow down, and then you can kind of trace the language, you know, through these things. Now, budgets are policy. You can have, you know, all the statements you want, but where's the money? And again, as anybody who's been in the business a while is probably familiar with this sort of chart. Where you had this gigantic peak at the beginning during the Apollo program, at one point being about almost 4.4% of all federal spending and 1.1% of GDP. We will never see those days again, okay? 1.1% of GDP is never going to happen again. Drops off after that, so, you know, when I was working at JPL in the 70s, you know, we were coming through this, you know, big gap. And Viking aside, you could get parking in the West parking lot. You know, 10 o'clock in the morning, there was still parking. Bad times. Some coming back up, but really being relatively stable. Now, as the charts, of course, are somewhat misleading because showing NASA as a percent of GDP or a percent of federal budget, you know, is always misleading because, of course, the GDP and the budget are generally growing. For the most part, in constant dollar terms, the NASA budget has been relatively flat. It went through kind of a long-term decline. There was a brief spike up around at the end of the Cold War in Bush 41, then went through kind of a long erosion through Clinton. There's been attempts to sort of reset the number up again, but really for a total NASA budget, it's been roughly flat. Now, something I like to point out, you know, with this spike up front, most people will look at that and go, oh, that's when things were good and people believed in space. No. Actually, if you go back and if you look at opinion polls in that period, people were very, very divided. People don't remember. There was, you know, actual, you know, counter demonstrations when Apollo was landing on the moon. People don't remember that there is a lot of controversy about these things, which your mind maybe edits it out in retrospect. What you got here with that big spike of money up front was not necessarily a statement of unanimity. What you're doing there is you're buying schedule. You know, Kennedy had put down a goal of beating the Soviets to the moon and getting there within a decade. And so if any of you have done project management, you know you've got things like cost, performance, schedule, risk, you know, pick any pair of them. And if you want one, you got to trade something else. So if you want to bring schedule up and your performance requirements are fixed and you're trying to drive risk down, what's going to happen? Your costs are going to go up. You're buying a lot of time is what you're doing with that spike. So that doesn't necessarily represent everybody loves you and is agreement and we all said, let's go spend 1% of GDP. It's this is what we've got to do to hit a schedule. If you don't have that kind of schedule driver, then you're not going to get a spike like that. You're going to get something that is going to be, you know, farther out and going to be stretched. So schedule then becomes a trade space for you in order to manage your peak budgets within what other political processes are going to allow. So in recent years, we've had a lot of volatility in the budget, not just, you know, representing policy changes, but representing other things impacting on NASA. Now, if you go to the, sort of the end of the Cold War, and if you were back in fiscal year 1992, in constant dollar terms, the NASA budget today would be about $24 billion compared to, say, roughly $18 billion, you know, today. So that's sort of a long-term erosion, if you will, from, you know, sort of the end of the Cold War. Now, this was the enacted budgets, monies that actually came in. Here's what happened in fiscal year 10 when the Augustine Committee report was being worked on and the Obama administration took a pause and said, you know, we don't know if we want to do what that those previous guys were doing. Let's put a pause in here. Basically about $3 billion in out-year money NASA was kind of put aside, you know, while the review of human spaceflight was going on and decision about whether or not they wanted to keep on going with the previous plan. So flat for that time period. When the 2011 budget came out, the budget went back up to basically the same rough top line, nominal growth about 2.4% a year, roughly with inflation, although inflation has been low the last several years, that actually would have represented maybe some real growth. Now, it's a little misleading because although it shows the line kind of continuing on the same rough path that it was before, the NASA budget request in 2011 was, of course, dramatically different. The Constellation program, Return to the Moon, all that was canceled. More monies were put into new technology. Monies were put into Earth science applications. So the top line was about the same, but the portfolio within that amount was very, very much different, reflecting the priorities of the new administration. But that didn't last. Then the next year, in 2012, went flat. So all the planning you did for the out-year projections, okay, so that went away. The next year was worse than that, and you dropped down in 2013. 2014 was a little bit better. This is now where the NASA headquarters managers are using the phrase, you know, flat is the new up. You know, please leave me alone. That would be progress. And here you're starting to see a little bit of out-year monies coming up. This is being taped, but I'll say it anyway. Never believe the OMB when they take money out of you in the near term and say they'll pay it back later. Okay? Just doesn't happen. But fiscal year 16 request is going back up a bit. And you notice that although the whole shift has gone out to the right, you notice that angle is roughly kind of where we would have been, you know, given all the trauma that we went on in between. Because roughly keeping up with inflation, constant dollar terms, you need to be growing at about, you know, 2.4% or so or better. Actually, among cost estimating nerds, and there is a subculture of them, the number is more like 3.1% in aerospace inflation indices, which OMB doesn't let us use because, you know, that would be bad. But in real terms, it probably is more like 3.1. So through all of this recent activity, it's been really, really hard to plan. Because when you're a program manager in this area, you're not just planning for what you're going to do today. You're planning, what am I doing in 5 years? You're planning your capital expenditures. And so you're having to keep in mind the budget I've got, the budget I might get, the budget that might happen to me later. So a lot of your work is really, you're trying to hedge your bets in this incredibly volatile environment, which we've had for the last few years. So where we are today is this phrasing of an evolvable Mars campaign. Most of you know from the 2010 space policy, we dropped discussion about you know, returning to the moon in favor of talking about the asteroid mission, as Tom mentioned, and also making Mars, you know, the long-term goal. And so here is the kind of the staging. Then we use phrases like Earth-reliant and proving ground in and around the moon, not really landing except maybe with robotics. In part for practical reasons, the U.S. paying for a lunar lander, say like the Altair system out of the Constellation program, very, very, very expensive. And if you look at what the budgets are there, it's not really clear that you would have enough money to pay for an Altair lander in the near term. Certainly not when you're trying to develop other things like Orion and SLS and so forth. And we can have a long discussion about programmatics and phasing and so forth, but, you know, landing on the moon would be expensive and paying for a lander would be expensive. And so this is an architecture that tries to fit within the existing budgets. Now, that I think is fairly reasonable in the near term. One of the problems with the far term, as many of the advocates know, is if you have a goal that's really, really far out, 2030 or something like that, it's really easy to cut that budget in the near term and dare anyone to show you there's an impact. Now, if you have a landing that's like 5 years out and you go cut it, say take $10 million out of the program, you can show that there's an impact. If something is really far out, it's kind of like having a discounted cash flow. If it's 30 years in the future, who's going to know? Okay, and that has political saliency because you can't show that there's a price. Again, referring back to cost estimating nerds, one of my favorite categories of people because it's where technology and policy and math all kind of meet. The thing that NASA has done in the last several years, which seems to have had actually really some good effect, is what are called joint confidence levels. There may be some groaning from any project managers out there. Okay, but what you do in joint cost confidence levels is you don't treat cost as a point, you treat it as a stochastic. There's a distribution that might happen. So if I go take money out of a system, it doesn't mean I can't execute the program, it means that the probability of executing the program on a particular schedule now goes down. So I might fund something at, say, a 70% confidence level. I have enough money, I got a 70% chance of sort of hitting a number, great. If I take a bunch of money out of it, the probability now drops to maybe 40%. That's very important in political terms because what you've done is you've now affixed responsibility. If somebody takes money out of your system, you say, okay, you now own the fact that you dropped the probability on this project by X percentage. If you have a line of your budget that says reserves, that's unallocated and who knows what it's going to be for, and somebody comes along and scrapes your reserves out, this has all happened to all of us, okay, again, what's the price of that? If you say it's bad and you wave your hands, that's really not going to be terribly convincing. If you're able to say, okay, here's how you've slipped schedule, here's how you've increased risk by joint confidence schedule functions, it may not be perfect, it may not be 100%, but there is an impact. And so revealing prices is a very, very important management characteristic you need to do if you're going to be preserving your program and understanding what the implications of shifting these budgets around. They're not costless sorts of exercises. And that's kind of like the opposite side of having a goal that's too far out. You want to show there are prices for hitting things that are very close to you. So one of the things that's also gone on is the U.S. is not, by itself out here. When the Vision for Space Exploration was released in the Bush administration, the head of the Canadian space delegation in D.C., Graham Gibbs, who was kind of the dean because he'd been in town the longest, and said, that's really good for you. You guys have got this statement, but, we don't have anything like that. We don't, our governments haven't made any decisions. So how are we supposed to talk with you? And, a lot of us said, you're right. And so what was created out of that was a global exploration strategy, which was a very, very informal grouping, had no power whatsoever, had no ability to commit anybody to anything. But it became the discussion forum that later evolved into the International Space Exploration Coordination Group, which is where you get all the major space agencies, including the Chinese and the Russians and the Indians and everybody, to sort of say, well, this is sort of what we're thinking about, this is what we're thinking about, and everybody can kind of see where they might conceivably fit. Now, you notice there's really not much in the way of dates along the bottom. It's all, very amorphous. Because if I start having dates, I could start having costs, and I would start having budgets, and all kinds of other things would chain up from that. So this is just conceptually, how would you work? It was very, very difficult until very relatively recently to have a discussion, because you had the Americans talking about going to Mars and the asteroids, and you had pretty much everybody else talking about the moon. Having us now talk about, so one of the merits, and I won't say there's many, but among the merits of the ARM mission, I would argue, is that it allowed the U.S. to talk about operations in cislunar space, which allowed us to get on the same page with really where a lot of our potential partners were. And so even though we weren't talking about lunar landing or anything like that as we did previously, we could talk about cislunar space and we could talk about coordinating activities in and around that region. Okay, how about the other guys, the cool kids? So one of my early jobs after I left RAND is I went to work in the Office of Space Commerce in the Department of Commerce in the early 90s. And, you know, there we could see several burgeoning things coming out because we were relooking at policies that had really been there frozen since the Cold War. So things like high-resolution remote sensing, civilian uses of high-precision GPS, having Russians, Chinese, and Ukrainians in the international launch market. Stuff that, you know, frankly, 5 years earlier when I was still a RAND graduate student would have gotten you laughed at because, you know, the Soviet Union was still there, the wall was still there, all that. So the Bush administration in 41 was really a very interesting time because it was one of those policy windows sort of opening, and you could start thinking about changes and differences that you couldn't prior to that time. So this business about space entrepreneurs has been around actually for a long while. It was around even earlier in the 80s. You can go back and find papers on space industrialization and people's hopes for the shuttle. You can find designs for building large solar power satellites. You know, everything old is new again. So for me, the current generation of entrepreneurs is about fourth or fifth generation of sort of these entrepreneurial waves that I've seen, each one being better financed, better funded, better planned, better technically than the one that goes before it. The other hand, they've all died with one or two exceptions. So again, it's very Darwinian in watching this process, but as I said, each generation tends to be better funded, you know, better organized, better capitalized, tougher technology. And so, you know, this is a snapshot of people like, again, I'm sure you're all familiar with today, doing a wide range of activities that, you know, previously we'd have thought of as only as governments. Now, there's serious money in this business. If you go to the Space Foundation, they put out an annual report, you know, with the very evocative title, Space Foundation Report. From 2012, they had this nice chart showing, you know, where the revenues were, at least as they estimated them. So number one, not surprising, ground terminals, equipment, that's kind of the most money. Number two, direct-to-home television. Number three, US DoD space activities. Okay, so DirecTV. And its ilk generate more revenues than the National Security Space Program. Other things, satellite services, again, putting photons up and down, generating money. NASA's in fifth, ESA's in sixth. Go down the line, we have, of course, in number 15, they like to say America's second civil space agency, NOAA, down there on the bottom. But if you look at this, you see sort of there's a mixture of national security activities, national pride activities, if you will, scientific prestige projects, things that make, you know, real money, things that are really all about sort of science and exploration, all sort of mixed up in here. So it's not as if there's one sector which is just dominant over everybody else. It's really a very, very dynamic and evolving one, which these guys, of course, want to take advantage of because where the frontier is for private activities is a very moving one. You can, of course, overshoot and try to do things that are way before your time, in which case you go bankrupt, or you can undershoot and not do things soon enough, in which case you're maybe wasting money and you're not putting resources really in the highest and best usage. And so picking where that frontier is at any time is, again, a real art form and is something people debate about in policy all the time. Kind of an overview picture of, you know, what are the trends. These growing activities, becoming a much more globalized environment. So, you know, as I was coming here, I was getting an email from a friend of mine who's coming back from an investor in Dubai. I was in the Middle East, you know, one time, and here's a bunch of South Koreans talking with, you know, Dubai folks, and they're doing something else with the Turks. And so it's not just Russians, Chinese, you know, and Americans. There is a whole much more globalized industry going on at very, very different levels all over the world. At the same time that this globalization is going on, there's an increasing number of non-state actors, private sector folks, and there's a debate about, well, how do you govern all this? You know, when you're in a bilateral environment, a Cold War environment, in some ways it's relatively simple, hostile and dangerous, but relatively simple. In this environment, it's much less controllable. I would argue that there's an increasing interest in issues of space governance, hence these UN meetings, almost in precise proportion to the difficulty of actually accomplishing any of this. And so this is a debate that I'll be happy to take questions on if you want. There are threats to the competitiveness of the U.S. in this environment. Probably among the two biggest ones, I would argue, is supply chain dependencies with the Russians. The RD-180 engine issue dependency, which the Atlas V uses, and of course you're probably all familiar with. Less well known is plutonium-238. I was working on this when I was in NASA, and we're still working on this. Okay, but there hasn't been a domestic source of plutonium-238 since shutting down Savannah River in the late 80s. We bought a lot of plutonium-238 from the Russians. That supply is out. So if we're going anyplace beyond Mars, seriously, Juno folks can take pride in what they've done. But really, if you want to be on Mars for a long period of time, you want to do really deep space exploration, you're going to need plutonium-238. And I would argue it's better for us to make it ourselves than to buy it or encourage it being produced by other people. But that's another non-proliferation argument. There's a number of regulatory burdens that have become problematic. So while in the end of the Cold War, we liberalized a lot of licensing issues, export controls, remote sensing licenses, space trade, and launch issues, like barnacles, they've kind of come back, particularly as technology has changed. There are new technical capabilities in remote sensing and new communications technologies that are producing challenges where the bureaucracy is going, we don't know how to think about this. And if we don't know how to think about it, our default action is to do nothing. You know, if the commercial markets are very simple, they're driven by fear and greed. Political markets are similarly simple. They're driven by blame and credit. And so, you know, the desire to avoid loss and to avoid blame is often a stronger motivation than to gain credit. For some of you who wonder about the deeper sides of this, I commend Tversky and Kahneman's Judgment Under Uncertainty. There's a whole psychological side to this that people can go look at. But nonetheless, the bureaucracy has trouble catching up with these kind of technical changes. And then finally, that instability in the civil space program that I showed earlier, with the budget charts going all over, and are we doing cislunar space, are we doing asteroids, whatever, that instability itself produces a problem. And probably the key problem right now is uncertainty about post-space station. Now, we're talking, Congress is passing, you know, we'll go to 2024, the Russians have said they're in for 2024, we're trying to get the Japanese to say they're in for 2024, but it's not a done deal. And part of the reason it's not a done deal is the decision about extending station is not primarily driven just by utilization questions. It's not driven just by questions of what kind of science am I going to do on board. It's driven by what are the political benefits that we get out of this. And part of that political benefit is not what benefits do I get over this next time period, but what comes after that. And so I argue that one of the disbenefits or headwinds we're facing on space station is not a clear vision about what comes after space station, at least in low Earth orbit. And so if you're some potential partner with the US and you say, great, I'm with you until 2024, what happens in 2025? And if there isn't really a good answer, then at a finance ministry level, you're like, and why? Why don't I just stop now and save, you know, 5-6 years of expenditure? And if you say, well, that's going to make all these scientists unhappy, the answer is, and? what was that? So the science and utilization is a necessary but not a sufficient condition to be able to answer why do you do the next thing. Now, nobody wants to do the station just simply for a stunt. Okay? Scientific validity is important. It's important that it be rigorous, important that there be good utilization out of it, but it's not sufficient. And part of what's missing in that sufficiency is being able to say, and what comes afterwards. So when you saw those earlier charts about, you know, space as a proving ground and all that, and ISIG, and you saw all the vagueness around it, that vagueness translates into an immediate uncertainty about what comes after the ISS, which in turn means, do I have partner commitments to keep on going, or do I really just wind this down right now? And you say, well, why not wind it down right now? We can take all that money and move it to something else. Again, another fallacy. Money is not fungible in that way. It is not like your checking account. If I don't spend it on this, I get to spend it on something else. The money is there because it is justified for some purpose, usually some compelling political purpose. And so if you don't have a compelling reason for what else you want to do with that money, the money doesn't become freed up. It basically disappears. Somebody else, it's not your money. The finance ministries will scrape that off the table. So an inability to articulate what comes next in a convincing way has really direct costs. It's not just I'm going to avoid a cost and this is my money and I'll spend it on something else. It's not really the way it's going to work. Okay, I've talked a lot about the U.S. space policy. Just to show here, you know, areas for international cooperation, and you can read some of the key things in there. These are listings of things that the political leadership values, and you notice a lot of them value things that have a direct benefit to people, you know, helping people avoid disasters, search and rescue, worrying about ship traffic, making sure I sustain the environment for future usage. Now, the security aspect is just as important, because at the same time as all these other countries are going up there and doing things, and non-state actors and private companies are doing things up there, you know, we have this language in the court of the kind of the code phrase is transparency and confidence building measures. Because what happens when somebody comes too close to you? If it's a friendly satellite and you're communicating with each other, that's maybe a few miles and meters may be fine. If it's an unfriendly satellite and you're not quite sure who has control of it, then maybe tens of kilometers away may make you nervous. What happens if somebody launches something? And do they let you know? Or do you wait till somebody picks it up on missile warning radar? What happens if somebody destroys a satellite in orbit and say, oh, you know, I was just kind of cleaning up some debris. Really? What did that mean? So there aren't rules in space beyond some very, very basic ones. Don't go placing weapons of mass destruction up there, you know, making sure, you know, no fortifications and a few other items. But space is a very permissive environment. If it's not expressly forbidden, it's permitted. And states can do really whatever they want. And so in an environment that doesn't have a lot of rules of the road for it, and you have a lot more drivers on that road, there's a lot of room for bad things to happen and mistakes to happen and for escalations, you know, to happen. During the Cold War, there is a lot of confrontation on the high seas between the US and Soviet navies. Some of the confrontations were rather sporty. Things like people simulating, you know, locking fire control radars on each other's conning towers, flying over and dropping things on decks, surfacing inside of fleet positions, a lot of shining bright lights on each other's conning towers. I mean, stuff that, you know, in retrospect you look at and go, this is crazy. And the senior naval officials on both sides agreed this was crazy. And so an agreement was put together called the Agreement for the Prevention of Incidences on the High Seas. Basically, it didn't mean that war wouldn't occur, but that it wouldn't be by accident. And so you can go Google this up, and you can look at Agreement for Prevention of Incidents of the High Seas, and you can see a whole bunch of actions which are forbidden by treaty between the US and Soviet, and now, of course, Russian Federation. And every one of those things that is forbidden are things that happen that people decide, you know, probably shouldn't happen again. So one can come up with other kind of space-related activities, like if you blow something up, make sure that you clean up all the debris afterwards or it comes back down. If you all saw the movie Gravity, of course, you know, things tend to stick around and come back at you, even though the orbital mechanics and that was all wrong. You know, Neil deGrasse Tyson was correct. And so the DOD will use phrases, Defense Department will use phrases, you know, I abuse them. I say, you know, you read too much Dr. Seuss, because they come up with congested and competitive and contested. You know, I'm so tired of alliteration, but, you know, it works in Washington. And so phrases, but they're not inaccurate. And if you just kind of go down the side, it's maybe hard to read in the back, there's been a whole bunch of activities. More recently, Chinese high-altitude orbital tests and non-destructive ASAT tests, but SATCOM jamming by Egypt and Iran, North Korean launch attempts, attempts at hacking into the Terra AM-1 and Landsat satellites. You know, back in 2002, Falun Gong jammed and hijacked TV stations on a Chinese CompSat, and you can imagine how that went over. So there are levels of both destructive and non-destructive activities that are happening in space now. Now, in theory, under parts of outer space treaties and so forth about preventing harmful activities, none of that should have happened. But in reality, all this stuff does happen. And so norms have effectively been established by practice. That this is the level that we're going to tolerate, because what are you going to do? Are you really going to go to war with somebody just because they jammed your satellite? Are you going to go to war because they blew up one of their own satellites? No. Are you going to go to war because they're jamming you? No. Okay. So What are the lines? What are the tolerance lines? Where are the boundary conditions? And again, as more and more people play in this, it becomes more and more dangerous. So one of the things that the Defense Department does, it produces manuals and doctrine on everything, from humanitarian relief to mine laying operations to counterinsurgency manuals. Well, there's a space manual, okay? Joint Publication 3-14, which lays out doctrine on this is the proper way and sets of missions that we should worry about. And one of the latest additions has been space situational awareness. The others are things like space launch, force support, force application, weapons in space. But this one is the more recent one, basically says, do you even know what's going on? Do you even have awareness about what's happening out there, which is fundamental to really doing anything about space for either peaceful or military purposes. Now, space surveillance and orbital debris closely link to each other. We worry not only about intentional creation of debris, we also worry about accidental ones, natural ones that can occur. So the whole planetary defense aspect of this stuff. And having a space surveillance network that can find and track all these sorts of objects and be able to tell you which one should I worry about, which one should I not. This is a really, really big burden that the Air Force does carry. They love for somebody else to do it. On the other hand, they don't really feel comfortable having someone else do it. So again, one of these things we debate on. This is some mention about my participation in the UN Committee on Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. So I'm a private sector person that goes along in the U.S. delegation. These are some of the things that we try to get agreement on, because we're not going to get agreement upon some new space treaty, but can we at least get agreement upon sustainability of activities? Here are things we ought to do to avoid making the environment worse. Guidelines for mitigating debris during our space operations, which I'm sure some of you have had to deal with. Probably next we're trying to work on how do we exchange information in a standardized way, such that if we see something, we can tell somebody and they understand what they mean, that there's a potential risk to them in a certain form. Worrying about the radio frequency interference, managing the electromagnetic spectrum, improving space safety, and even talking about regulatory practices. All of this is driven from much more of a technically based, bottom-up sort of approach. This is not having big politicals make a decision and floating it down. It's basically having practitioners kind of talk with each other and kind of go, I don't know, what would be sensible for us? Yeah, well, this would be sensible. Then it goes through a political machine, and the people who are perfectly reasonable across from you in the working group now become unreasonable when they, when it gets into plenary sessions and it becomes more of a political issue. I've had this with my Russian counterparts, I mean, perfectly reasonable when we're in the expert working groups, but when it shifts into more of a political positioning, I have to shut up because I'm not the State Department rep, and the Russian counterpart is much, much more difficult. But the nature of international politics. So picture from the most recent meeting, if anybody knows, the portion of the head of the woman there on the left is Sandy Magnus, who's head of AIAA, and she was on the last STS-135 mission and was there on the Dell, so we're there in the back row. And working through, grinding through, these sorts of guidelines. Very, very slow going. Somebody once said slow boring through hard wood. But it actually does represent consensus. You will get the South Africans and the Brazilians, the Europeans, the Japanese, and the Chinese, kind of all nodding and going, okay, we're good with this part of this. And so it's a very slow process, but the consensus aspect of it, I think, is very powerful. The Europeans are trying a much more top-down approach. They had negotiations in New York at the end of this last month in July. It's not going as well for them. I could go into details as to why. They're trying to go directly for a code of conduct, not some of these softer guidelines, but really rules of the road procedures. If you do something, notify, don't come this close. If you need to destroy an object for safety purposes, here's the conditions under which you can do it. There's a lot of opposition to this, mostly from developing countries who are concerned that it's being done outside of the UN, so they argue about its legitimacy, and a lot of opposition from the Russians, who believe that this would create some international norm for the use of force in space, albeit maybe for a good purpose, but one that they've opposed, at least on paper, doing themselves. There also is not a little bit of opposition to the European Union itself, because the Russians argue the European Union is not a member state of the UN. Why should I bother listening to them? And you can imagine how that goes into current environment with Ukraine and all the rest. The kinds of things that that worry people, you know, this is a public sourced list from some friends of mine at Secure World Foundation about recent Chinese ASAT tests. Now, it's hard to criticize China for doing ASAT tests. Certainly, we the United States did them, the Soviet Union did them. So developing the capability per se is not something that I think that you can say is any violation of international law. On the other hand, it does mean the development of what we call counterspace capabilities. And you sort of naturally ask the question, what's it going to be used for? Because the reason we stopped doing ASAT developments, and the Russians, at least for the most part, stopped, though not completely, is because on net, the advantages of using an ASAT were outweighed by the disadvantages about the damage created to the space environment, the lack of really military benefit, other problems that were created. So when we see another country, I could probably, you know, India has talked about creating ASAT capabilities, which of course also make us nervous. China has probably done much more in this regard, and of course the issues of intent. What's it for and why? It's not so much whether they have it, but why do they have it? So this is a piece from some Senate testimony that I did earlier this year. And what I argue, where this all comes back to space policy, is the top line where I say, you know, international cooperation, commercial space activities, and even international security discussions could be done in a more integrated way. Right now, they're done very, very much in separate silos. And they could be used to reinforce each other. That is, if you want people to cooperate with you on rules of the road and space or something, it kind of helps if they're doing something with you. So the people that we've had the easiest conversations with have been, I don't know, the Europeans and the Chinese. Not the Chinese, the Europeans and the Japanese. We've had good conversations with the Chinese on some of the rules of the road discussions. We've had some others that have been much more difficult. Would that be better, maybe, if there was a broader cooperative activity going in where people felt they had a stake? Yeah, maybe. And so one of the areas where I'm very critical of the administration's policy on Mars and asteroid missions is twofold. One is it doesn't provide enough opportunity for international participation because they are very, very ambitious goals, and therefore there's only a limited number of countries that can participate. And I'm also critical of it because it doesn't provide a lot of opportunities for private sector participation, except as contractors. Whereas the moon, cislunar space, low Earth orbit, you know, in maybe mercantile terms, there are a lot of different price points. And so if you want to get in at some small level from a modest space agency, you can in a LEO or a lunar operation. It's a much, much bigger step, first rung of the ladder, to play at the Mars or asteroid level. And in today's environment, the measure of goodness is not, gee, do we do something by ourselves and impress everybody else, which was kind of the measure in the 60s. Today, the measure of goodness, I would argue, is the degree to which you can get other people to come along with you, the degree to which you're the indispensable country, to which everybody wants to play with you because you're doing the most cool stuff and there's things for them to do. Do you provide an opportunity for people to do that and fit into that and get partners, commercial partners, international partners, or do you proceed, and I would argue our current policy is in many ways a weird throwback to an Apollo-like structure, which doesn't really take into account the kind of globalization and private sector developments that have happened in the intervening years. So we need to ask, what can our partners, what would they like to do? What are they capable of doing? And again, and I'll get some argument maybe from folks in the audience, I would argue that the moon, not with Mars eliminated. Mars is a stretch goal. It is a challenging goal. It is a kind of a penultimate goal. But I would argue that getting there is something that needs to build a larger organization. It's not a matter of just technically can you do it. It's a matter of can you do it in a way that's sustainable in budget and political terms over a long period. And thus, we need to align our policies and programs with these enduring interests that come from the top. You know, the problem, again, in human spaceflight with a lot of people, enthusiasts, maybe many in this room, is you ask, say, human spaceflight, you say, what was the question? The answer it comes back with is, well, human spaceflight, what was the question? Human spaceflight, what was the question? Okay, instead, you have to ask, what question to whom the answer is human spaceflight. In the case of Kennedy, human spaceflight to the moon was an answer to a political question he had. Is there any way we can beat the Soviets at anything in space? And he chose something, the moon, because one, there was actually some technical work that was done enough by von Braun that it was probably feasible, but it was so hard that it was probably an even race. Even building a space station, Soviets might have beat us to that because they were already that good. You need to pick something really, really hard. Other things, Apollo Soyuz mission, as I mentioned, symbolizing an era of detente. What better way to do that than for a link up in space? Bringing the Russians into the space station program as a way of symbolizing hopes for a post-Soviet relationship. So for all of those reasons on the first chart that why we do things in space, a lot of those reasons will still continue to exist for commercial and military and scientific purposes. But human spaceflight, I will argue, will in the real world be driven by mostly geopolitical concerns. Not 100% of the time, but most of the time by these geopolitical concerns. And so it requires a reading of what is the geopolitical environment we're in, and how do we align, you know, our interests with what the space community can do for us as national leaders or policymakers, not what does the space community want to do. I mean, that's important, that has to be in there, but that's not dispositive, it's not sufficient. So I, you know, going back to the point about there's no decadal survey for human spaceflight, and there arguably can't be, given the nature of the human spaceflight community. But one of the things that decadals do, which is very, very powerful, is they ask questions. They don't start with assertions. They start with, like, you know, is there life in the universe, or is there life on other planets? Well, I'm going to go look where there's water, and then I'm going to send a mission to look for the water, and so forth. You drill down. I would argue in that the human spaceflight business, the question is there a future for humans in space? And the answer is yes or no. And we actually don't know whether the answer is yes or no. And this is kind of like the question of, is there intelligent life in the universe? Both yes and no are profound answers. And if you look at answering the question, you know, is there a human future in space, and not just as a faith-based action, but as a something that you can test, it breaks down into parts. Can you live off the land, or do you always have to come back to Earth? Is there anything economically useful to do there? Or are you always basically living off the taxpayer nickel? If the answer to both questions is yes, commercially sustainable, you can live off the land, you get some science fiction vision. You get space settlements. You get stuff that we all kind of, you know, grew up on. If the answer is there's nothing really commercially useful to do out there, but you can use local resources, then maybe space is like some version of Antarctica. No penguins, but there might be tourists and scientists and things like that. If you can't live off the land and there's nothing useful to do, then people will still go to space as a form of adventure. I mean, space tourism will still probably happen for wealthy or even medium range individuals. And it's some form of Mount Everest. You know, you can pay someone to put yourself on Everest. Of course, there's a 1 in 62 chance of dying going on Everest. And if you're over 50, it's higher. But never mind, there is a known risk. Okay. If you can't live off the land, but there is something commercially sustainable to do out there, then maybe it's like a North Sea oil platform. You go and work in a hostile environment, and you come home, and you benefit the Earth. But those are four very radically different human futures. We don't really know which one it is. And the purpose of exploration, I would argue, is to answer these kinds of questions with international commercial partnerships, with science and technology, with robots and people, to answer a question of, is there a human future in space? Because, and it's back to the political one, that if there is a human future in space, if three of those four do have some sort of human future, then I want the values of my society to be represented out there. I want the values of a liberal, tolerant culture, of a democratic political system, of a mixed market economy to be part of what is out there, what values are out there. I don't mind other countries and other cultures being out there, but I don't want them there without me. And so if I'm a partisan of my society or country or Western civilization or whatever one wants to be grandiose about it, then I want to be present on that frontier, and it's worth doing that experiment. Not worth spending 1% of the GDP next year, but worth doing this motion, doing this direction, and having an exploration effort that's worthy of the name. The last charts, let's see, this one and this one, I just leave as an exercise for the reader. because these are just my list of what are the top international issues and questions. If someone says, what are the issues in international space policy? These are it. If I ask, what are the issues domestically? These are it. On this one, you know, our relationships with Russia and China, what happens with India, where is Japan going, Europe going, space situational awareness, how is that cooperation going to be evolving, what are the international frameworks for commercial activities in space? These are all the questions that are embedded in what does this frontier look like. So I'm in a school of international affairs today, and you know, most people deal with, you know, the colored maps, positions, and sovereign countries. And the most interesting questions to me today are the ones that are beyond the colors on the map. They're areas which are not really owned by anybody. So the high seas, the air above the high seas, space, cyberspace, the areas beyond traditional sovereignty. That's where the cutting edge of international affairs is occurring, the relationship of states and non-state actors in that environment. And the rules and frameworks we make up here are the ones that are shaping what our relationship will be. At home, we've got a whole bunch of internal issues, a lot of them very programmatic ones, management challenges, role of R&D and innovation, you know, problems between the administration and Congress, and again, we could dive down fairly deeply in each of those. But if you pull out from them what might be some really common themes, they're not really space themes. They're really, again, very philosophical ones. What's the role of the United States in the world? What is the relationship of government and industry to each other, and what is the proper role? If you tell me your views, or if a politician tells me their views on those sort of exogenous inputs, I'll tell you what space policy, you know, will follow from that. Because in the end, space is in the service of national interests, you know, not the other way around. So how do we get that right in a way that's consistent with our all our other interests, economic, scientific, military, and so forth? And I've run a little long, but let me... Sorry. Okay, I'll let this load. Okay, it does load. And, you know, after all that, I've got to give you the other side of the argument. Can we kill the light a little bit? Some of you have seen this, but if you haven't seen it.